For the last about 19 years, I've had the privilege of working with new American families in this community in a variety of ways, people who have come here from other countries. And anyway, this song is it's a song by Joe Jackson. It's just just a reminder of where we've all come from. From far away, distant lands, the tempest tossed with hopeful hearts and callous hands, reach for the light, the torch held high, and cast their gaze upon the Lady of the Harbor. And she welcomes them with open arms. She says, let my children in. Shine on. Oh, you Lady of the Harbor. So it was with my own kin. They sailed from Sweden and from France and Ireland, their earthly cares packed in their bags. They cast their gaze upon the Lady of the Harbor, and she welcomes them with open arms. She says, let my children in. Shine on. Oh, you Lady of the Harbor. Now we're locking down the borders and filling up the jails, and we say they don't belong. How conveniently do we forget that we woke up to sing the same sweet song? Will the dream survive the strain? Will huddled masses have a chance to learn its sweet refrain? Or will we fall into our fear and turn our backs against the Lady of the Harbor? And she welcomes them with open arms. She says, let my children in. Oh, you Lady of the Harbor, shine on. Oh, you Lady of the Harbor, shine on. Oh, you Lady of the Harbor, oh, you Lady of the Harbor.
Thank you. Being applauded before you speak is always interesting. Thank you. We had a fun time with Don last week, and she called on Monday, I think it was, to Cheryl let her know that she had actually taken the microphone home, but it showed up in the mailbox when I went down this morning to check. So that's kind of fun. Thanks for that great song. We're going to talk about it a little bit more as we're going on this morning. It's always interesting. Joanne asked me today, Cheryl always asked me today about what my theme is for my talk, and I never really have one because I've got too many things I'm trying to say at once. So. I apologize for that, because you like a theme. But today I do want to talk a little bit about Lammas, about the pagan holiday that we've just crossed, the 1st of August, and sort of where that fits within the seasons, and how it might also fit within our seasons of our lives of faith. Some about connections. We got another Mary Oliver poem we're going to make you listen to. And then particularly want to talk a little bit about how our faith informs how we welcome a stranger. And I think that song really set us up well for that. And then how we live our truth in the world in response to some of the pains that are out there. So I'll be open to this issue. And I really missed holding my finger up during that song. When I was a kid, we always held our finger up when we sang this little white line. I distract myself. So August 1st, again, the pagan calendar is Lammas. And so for me, as many of you know, if you've been here on Sundays, I follow the different holidays as far as the planet goes. And this time of year, for those of us who garden, of course, it's the time when things are coming into fruition. I love the old Irish tune. We should do that here sometime. away, but I know that John Barleycorn must die. So the odd thing is that sort of the seeds that were planted in the spring, which we enjoyed with such life, actually need to die in order to sustain us through the winter. So it's an interesting, again, that life-death, life cycle that we live in and celebrate all the time. But at our place anyway, at this time of year, it's very obvious that this is the harvest time. Things are starting to brown a little bit outside. I've garlic curing in our garden shed right now. We're eating kale, tomatoes, beans, peas, etc. All of you who garden or going to farmers markets are eating the same things. We're freezing green beans and peas and summer squash and cabbage and cauliflower and corn and even making pizza crust out of zucchini finally. God knows there's so much zucchini to deal with at this time of year. And trips to the food shelf, of course, with our extras, canning tomatoes, getting ready to dig potatoes, storing carrots in our wood cellar, and shelling beans as we move into the fall. And recognizing again that the seeds that we planted this last spring have really been so full bloom with us throughout the summer and bearing fruit. And now it's time to put storage and think about the darkness to come and that cycle that we are in as well. And I think metaphysically, it's a similar question. We see things in a new light with these longer days. Don't you just feel differently? I talked to many of you about how odd it was to start here in the dark of winter last December. The building was cold and trying to get a handle on things in the midst of that darkness. Whereas the summer has been so easy to celebrate our lives of faith and to celebrate the world around us because it's just so full of color. But now as we turn the corner, it's back to us to have the tasks of what do we need to store from this time of richness as we move into the winter. I know it's August, I shouldn't be talking about winter, my apologies, but we have turned a little bit. And I think that's a good question as we do think about our own gifts as well. I think about classes that are coming up here at Unity, or I know Quest is coming to a close finally after 18 years, how long y'all been doing that? Whatever that is for you as you move into the fall. And then I'm going to risk, I love something Don said last week about how when things are important to us, we do repeat them. And so I'm going to repeat an image, some images here that I've brought many times to this place. Mary Oliver, when she passed this last year, and we've got the book that she actually got the Pulitzer Prize for, which I didn't know. So I'm going to read a poem for you. It's called Claps Pond. 3 miles through the woods, Claps Pond sprawls stone gray among oaks and pines in the late winter fields, where a pheasant blazes up, lifting his yellow legs under bronze feathers, opening bronze wings. And one doe, dimpling the ground as she touches its dampness sharply, flares out of the brush and gallops away. By evening, rain. It pours down from the black clouds, lashes over the roof. The last acorns spray over the porch. I toss one, then two more logs on the fire. How sometimes everything closes up, a painted fan, landscapes and moments flowing together until the sense of distance, say between me and Claps Pond, vanishes. Edges slide together like the feathers of a wing. Everything touches everything. Later, lying half asleep under the blankets, I watch while the doe, glittering with rain, steps under the wet slabs of the pines, stretches her long neck down to drink from the pond 3 miles away. So again, the image, I should have given you a picture, Sherry, but that's going to be for pictures, is of a feather. While sometimes everything closes up, a painted fan, landscapes, moments flowing together until the sense of distance stay between Claps Pond and me, stay between Jim and me, stay between Karen and me, between us together. Vanishes, the distance vanishes. Its edges slide together. Like feathers of a wing, everything touches everything. Just one more image of the unity, the connections that we all share. Another image, if you will, a feather of the connectedness of all of creation. Within unity, again, as Don really eloquently expressed last week, for those of you who are able to be here, that connecting element, of course, the glue, right, if you will, is the divine spark, which inhabits all creation. That divine spark. We have so many different names for it. And yet it's a challenge to see it sometimes, even after we've come through this season of light. I don't know what the blocks are for that understanding for you. For me, as many of you already heard me say, I have ongoing questions about even the need for divinity in this picture of the connectedness of, the world, right? For others, it might be difficult looking into the mirror in yourself. You know, it recognizes that divine presence is in you. And sometimes we have trouble with that. Or perhaps it's hard to see it in the eyes of the other, of the stranger, right? The stranger in our midst. Or perhaps even more challenging for us, sometimes it's hard to see for that person we really know well who irritates the you know what out of us, right? That's when it really gets, it's almost easier when it's someone out here. But those inside our communities, inside our families, sometimes that's the toughest to see that. Or, and some of the news we hear almost daily now, it could be the absurdity of our charge, if you will, and I believe we have this charge, to see the divine in those who commit acts of cowardice or acts of hate. That's a tough charge. It's a tough charge. It's easy to see divinity in the sunshine and the flowers, but not so easy in those eyes. And then, of course, the stretch to the best of creation. That's a challenging thing. For those of us in the West, I think that's another challenge, to move beyond the human, if you would. And I think I've told the story before about one of our guests on Sunday, who came a couple Sundays, wanted to have Bobby with me to learn a little bit more about unity, asked me a great question about what is it, why do we come together on Sunday? What are the different components of our service mean? And I hemmed and hawed, I even think I talked about it the next Sunday, because I found it such a striking question. We went through all the different aspects of our service. But a simple answer that I had that day, and it was reflected in one of our songs that actually oftentimes is around here, is that we gather in community to remember who we are. That we gather together with other people who help us remember who we already are. And whether that's that sacred spark, whether it's that person who allows grief to be a part of our lives, that we celebrate together, we come here together to remember who we actually are. And so together we have music, we have prayer, we have a message, meditation, offering, service, celebration, grieving together. Some of our disciplines, right, to remember who we are. Individually, we have disciplines of meditation, of contemplation, of conversation, of listening, deep listening if we're on our game, of service, and I would suggest of action. These are all disciplines that help us remember who we actually are. Now, I did forget to ask, can anyone speak German in here? Oh, great. So there's the great German author, G-O-E-T-H-E. How do you pronounce that? It's Goethe, right? God, it just doesn't look like Goethe to me. Okay, so anyway, thank you. So Goethe, John Price, the reflection piece I read this week, was reflecting on trees in Goethe's Germany. It's a very interesting story. And by the way, this is just a sidelight. Really an interesting thing I discovered, that in one of the concentration camps in Germany, there was a giant oak tree, and that the prisoners would oftentimes read one of his poems about love underneath this tree. It was a way of reminding themselves that life still existed outside of their horrible circumstances, which I thought was such a beautiful thing. He was such a strong presence in their minds that they would recite this poem under this tree about what it is to love and be loved. This author had visited there. The tree's gone now, sadly. Anyway, just something really struck me this week as I was reading about this. So I'm not real acquainted with Goethe's work, but I'm aware that he had great influence on some of the American Transcendentalists, which are at the root of some of Unity's teachings, like Henry David Thoreau and Emerson. And so that's to find that kind of interesting. One thing this author suggested that within his mind, the research, again, if you're looking at the world, how the world operates, should be verifiable by applying the unaided senses and drawing from the materials at hand. So think about that. We usually think about knowledge as digging in deeper, using microscopes, and today God knows what we're using for research. But one thing he believed, and of course was embraced by many American Transcendentalists, was the idea that everything we have right in front of us, simply paying attention, as Mary Oliver would say, is one of the ways that we learn and add to the body of knowledge that's around us. And so for me, when I think about remembering who I am, in relation to the rest of creation, I'm best aided when I do it, unaided by anything other than my senses, whether it's walking our labyrinth, or whether it's working in the garden, doing things with my hands. A quality that this person suggests that we need in that process, he's talking about scientists, but I would suggest for all of us who want to engage in the world to find out how it actually operates and what our place is in it. And according to Goethe, any amateur, if she or he is careful and disciplined observer, as well as a creative thinker, can make original contributions to knowledge. It occurs to me now that this is the way of many essayists who model a research process that can be replicated not only by those within privileged academic and economic classes with their access to research libraries and travel funds and wealth of time, but by anyone who has the power to bring new attentiveness to what may have previously seemed unexceptional. In short, anyone who is curious. That last piece. Bring that to our surroundings, right? Bring that here on Sunday. A new attentiveness to what may have previously seemed unexceptional. Anyone, in short, who is curious. Curiosity. What a great gift we can bring to our engagement with the world around us. And I would suggest that in our disciplines of meditation, of contemplation, of conversation, of service, of action, that we are called to bring a new attentiveness to what may have previously seemed unexceptional. To try to bring that each day, a new attentiveness to what was normal the day before. An honest curiosity, if you will. And I believe in my heart that it will continue to bring us back to the place of seeing our connectedness with all of creation. We'll recognize that oneness with a little bit of our attention. So I want to speak a little bit about welcoming the stranger. Why do we do that? Why do we welcome those who are new to our community who might be different than us? Not because we're trying to appease some far-off Father God with a beard who's going to kick us if we don't do it, right? We kind of set that aside here, I think, thankfully. But because we see the divine spark in them as well. I love when Rick, I'm going to call you out of it, just, Rick kind of told me about this song we just did, about whether it was too political to do on a Sunday morning. So I want to give my answer a little bit. And part of that is I think we get confused about what's political and simply what is righteous. And I think that, especially if it's in the law of churches, of course, you can't support candidates. So I'm proud to say that there were, when I ran for Senate, there were a couple of parishes that were preached against voting for me, I found out here in central Minnesota. Interestingly, you can ask me about that later. So they slapped in jail over that. That's, again, another aside. But I actually went when Rick told me about the song and listened to it, and then I went and looked for the full statement that's on the Statue of Liberty. We know the part about bringing your poor, your child, but I want to read this to you. It's a beautiful piece. It's written by, the entire song was written by Emil Lazarus, and it's called The New Colossus. Not like the brazen giant of Greek fame, with conquering limbs astride from land to land, here at our sea-washed sunset gates shall stand a mighty woman with a torch, whose flame is the imprisoned lightning, and her name is Mother of Exiles. From her beacon hand glows worldwide welcome, her mild eyes command the air-bridged harbor that Twin Cities frame. Keep ancient lands your storied pomp, she cries with silent lips. Give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to breathe free, the wretched refuse of your teeming shore. Send these, the homeless, tempest-tossed to me. I lift my lamp beside the golden door. Tempest-tossed. I love, in my class, I always talk to our students, one of my favorite lines about people who complain about newer immigrants is, they say, and you've, I'm sure you've heard this, well, my ancestors came here illegally. Why are you just crossing the border? I always point out to them, for most of our ancestors, legally meant getting off a boat and walking on the streets of New York City. there were no barriers. So it's just such an interesting argument. But there are many arguments for welcoming new people in our community, welcoming the other, if you will. The Chamber of Commerce will tell you we need more workers, right? Those of us who would like to have Social Security when we retire, we need more workers, right? So that's, we know that. There's just a real common sense thing to that for those of us who want Social Security and Medicare. Humanitarians, of course, say, because we need to respond to suffering. And there's all kinds of good reasons why we welcome people. And yet, deeper, more sustaining argument, I would suggest, that we welcome new people is that we see in their humanity our humanity. And we see in their divine spark our divine spark. So when we offer a hand to another, we're actually offering a hand to ourselves. I think we have a message to bring to this conversation here. So, in response to that, how do we live in this world? My favorite principle among the five unity principles. How do we live our truth in this world? I had a quote here from Toni Morrison. I'm sure many of you read her work too. She passed away this last week, so I had to charge around until I could find something. And I found this lovely piece. She was quoted in The Guardian saying, she said, I tell my students, when you get these jobs that you have so brilliantly trained for, just remember that your real job is that you are free and you need to free somebody else. You are free, and you need to free somebody else. This is not just a grab bag candy game. Life is not a grab bag candy game. But if you're free, how can you not free someone else? Now, as I can use one of the things that I'm aware of is it's really easy to be overwhelmed when one starts to move in our time into how do we respond to some of the challenges in our world. And you have your list too. Some of the shootings of late have clearly been motivated by hate and xenophobia. The climate crisis with children are leading the way, letting us never ever forget what we're living in the midst of and help create. Even this week, as I still mark the anniversary of the dropping of the bomb, 74 years now since we dropped the bombs in Hiroshima and Nagasaki. So just things that are challenging. Targeting trans people of color, which has seemed to grow now in this country. Again, just things that are out there. And I know you have your list too. There's many things to be concerned about. And one of the biggest challenges I find, again from my work with our students on racism, is that we tend to focus so much on individual actions as opposed to systemic things. So we worry about whether Joe Blow is a racist, for example, as opposed to what is the system that has made this possible? What's the system that feeds this? Because we know the only lasting change is systemic change. However, at the same time, it does boil back down to what can we do in this place. Right? Now, my partner has talked about wanting to run down to the border, I'll be honest with you, our evenings of grumbling about the paper. She said, I want to be one of the people handing water out of the border. I want to be in the desert. And I really respect that. I respect people to do that. I happen to live here. And so the question becomes, how do we do it in our place? Wendell Berry, who some of you may know, great poet, author, teacher, novelist, as well as essayist, had a note in his book on the unsettling American culture and agriculture. He observes this: no matter how much one may love the world as a whole, one can only live fully in it by living responsibly in some small part of the world. We can only love the world by living in some small part of it. Where we live and who we live with there will define the terms of our relationship to the world and to humanity. Who we live with, how we live with people, defines how we relate to the entire world. Thus, we come to the paradox that one can become whole only by the responsible acceptance of one's partiality. So again, for me, the comfort of saying the stuff that's out there is to say, what can I do here? How can I be a part? How can I express my humanity? How can I live my truth in this place and this time? And that's not easy. Because faith communities, as you all know, just to come back down to this place, faith communities can and have found themselves, I think, in my experience, at two ends of the spectrum sometimes. A focus running from exclusively internal focus to an external focus. Okay? And in my opinion, one of my critiques of many organized religions is that they're so focused, I would say this about some of the megachurches now, they're so focused internally, and it looks really great if you're a part of that, that the focus outside disappears. I think at Unity, my sense here has been there's been both. There's been both that focus on the internal, the care within the community, the internal, the meditative piece, the contemplative piece, but also a desire to be engaged, to bring that truth out. And not in an evangelical, zealous way, like some of our brothers and sisters do, because no one can be saved unless they come here. I think we know better than that. There's many paths to that. But out of a living of our truth, if you would. And it seems to me that also, this is a place where we have a place to offer for comfort, for grief, for meditation, for study, contemplation, celebration, and that living in that space is one of the ways that we do express our love for the world and eat some food together. I think that's another thing this place does really well. So I'm hoping that Unity continues to be that place of challenge, of service, of action, and even agitation, perhaps, when the need arises. And there's many options coming up, by the way, that have grown out of this community, which I'm really excited about. And again, as I think about things which come to fruition, I've really been impressed with some of the things that happened here. The work now to provide supplies for homeless women in our community. The invite we have from some other folks in the community to be invited in a picnic, Community Unity. Nice thing, easy thing to do. Participation in the upcoming Pride Festival, ways that we are in the community to say this is who we are. The Isaiah Listening Project, which I heard some excited people talking about last week who were part of that first conversation. And how we can move into the community as a whole to see the sacred in all of our neighbors. We also have, I just set up this week, which I'm excited about. Some of you know about Unite Cloud. They're the group that's been really doing some work on welcoming folks in our community, no matter where they're from. And we're going to be having the director lead the message here one time in September, and then we're doing a workshop for the whole area of Sartell. They have a grant, so we're able to host for Sartell a workshop on moving from indifference to action. So that's another thing I think it's interesting that the board supported and that this place has supported. When I started here last December, I would say, I had more than one person tell me, this was the first one right here, this community is more than this building. That this community is more than this building. Not to deny the tremendous resource that this property is and can be for Unity in the larger area. And yet the power of this place is the people who are in this place. Right? That's the power of this place. I just learned an interesting term this week, a minyan, I think, I don't know how to pronounce it, but in Judaism, as I understand, a minyan is a gathering traditionally of 10 men, traditionally against men, who would be called together when there was a need to claim consecrated ground, to claim holy ground, a holy space. And in this tradition of over 5,000 years of persecution and homelessness, right, holy ground had to be portable. So they had a system that said, when we get this many people together, this is a sacred space, and then we can do the things we do when we have consecrated ground. I think that's such an interesting image. That the idea, again, basically from a tradition where running away is sadly in such a part of the tradition, right? But that the idea of you gather some people together, and then that is sacred ground. And I think with an understanding of the universality of the presence of the divine, I would suggest that we might agree that holy ground is indeed portable, right? And ours to be expressed in all of our interactions with our neighbors. I have been moved in my time here by the hunger to this place. I love the very first thing I get to hear when I walk in the door, that this place welcomes people from all different backgrounds, right? That is such a brilliant thing and a nice reflection of the lady from the water. And I think that that's a great thing that this place will continue to celebrate. So those are seeds I've seen planted here that I see come into fruition at all different times. And I just continue to hope that the gifts that these gifts that we create together will fill the larder as you and this place continue to shine both within and without. And so it is. Breathe out deep, not to really empty. then con. Read out ease. Smile as you breathe in. And then release. Breathe in, allowing yourself to be in the present moment. Breathe out, recognize this as a sacred moment. As you continue to breathe in and breathe out, I'd ask you to imagine some of the gifts you bring to this place, to your relationships. Things which have been bright and clear this summer, the fruits that you've recognized. Allow your gifts to enjoy your breathing in and out of the Spirit's breath. Recognizing in this place and this time, your gifts, what you have to offer, is part of the healing of this world. So again, breathe in nice and slow. Nurture those gifts. Breathe out nice and deep. Be calm with your gifts as you breathe in. Be at ease. Smile and thanks for your gifts. Release, recognizing they're available to all. These gifts are present as you breathe in. You're part of the sacred moment. And thank you for being. Whether you know it or not, each of you represents a spark of inspiration within the great mystery. You are needed. You touch the lives of many and are responsible for changing the lives of others for the better. For all that you do and for who you are, I thank you for being. So as you at your pace, open your eyes and come back to the room. Remember, please, that you are needed. Each of you represents a spark of inspiration within the great mystery. You touch the lives of many, and you are responsible for changing the lives of others for better. And so it is.
I've been camped out at the Bluegrass Festival all week with Alan Breezy and Michael O'Hara, and before we went out there, decided who was going to prepare what meal, you know, you're responsible for two suppers and breakfast or whatever. So, for suppers, you know, Mike brought pork chops and Alan brought steak and Mike mentioned zucchini and I brought zucchini soup that Christina made that had morel mushrooms in it, by the way, that Dean had picked and given to us. And then one of my breakfasts was zucchini pancakes, and the other was a veggie omelet with zucchini and other vegetables from the garden. So it's that season. Anyway, none of which is a segue into this song.